as a recruiter, have a couple of jobs, and you know, I was director of recruitment for years, which is a great job because you count it with a yes. And then in 2009, I also became director of admissions, which is a challenge because you have to tell people no. And that's a whole kind of different thing, which is kind of challenging. I was listening to what you were talking about earlier. Let me just add this. A lot of campuses will offer you self-guided tour information. So if you can't get the formal tour, they're packed or something, like our campus literally will give you something so you can do a self-guided tour. I would say if you work with former students and you can get that self-guided tour, that might be just as effective, if not more effective, than going along on the official tour, because they know your students, because maybe they were one of your students from that high school, so they can really talk about their experiences, and I think sometimes that connects better. We have great tour guides, don't misunderstand me, but I'm just saying that's something to consider as well. Okay, so I'm Director of Admissions and Recruitment. Admissions has changed so much on this campus, I'd say in the last 5 or 6 years. 5 or 6 years ago, first of all, as you all know, we were a quarter campus, right? So now we're a semester campus. But literally, when school used to start in September, I'd say maybe about 6 years ago, 7 years ago, a high school counselor could call me in August and say, I have this great kid who is going to go to Berkeley or going to go wherever. It fell through. Can you take him in? Fine, no problem. You know, Cal State used to be able to do that. Those days are long gone. If a student does not apply by November 30th of the previous year, they're done. Cal State LA now gets about 58,000 undergraduate applications.
Oh my goodness.
Wow.
Okay? We get about 37,000 freshman applications. We have a class of about 3,800 freshmen. So as you can see, there's a lot of students who, they miss deadlines, it's not a good thing. So if there's any message I want to leave with you, it's that make sure your students are adhering to deadlines, because, and I can speak to Cal State LA specifically, I can talk about the CSU in general. When you look at college admissions for the CSU in the LA Basin, with the exception of Dominguez Hills, we're all impacted. That terrible word, impacted, which means that we get more applications than we have spaces for. So one thing, if nothing else, I want to leave you with is just students you're working with, deadlines are everything. And I'll be honest with you. We know more students are going to apply and be admitted. That's how the class gets cut back. People who miss the deadlines get dropped off. And some campuses adhere to that more than others. I know we are very much adhering to that now, but that's a big part of the process. So let me walk you through the process and answer any questions you have. Stop me in the middle, or I can ask you questions at the end. So, big challenge this year. How many people know that CSU Mentor is gone? Okay, there's no more CSU Mentor. It's now called Cal State Apply. We are still in the process of learning what Cal State Apply does and how it works and things like that. In the long run, I think it's going to be a better application. For instance, there's only one application now. And so it's a smart application, and how you answer the first couple of questions will determine whether or not we're going to give you the international application, whether we're going to give you the graduate application, or whether you get a domestic undergraduate application. Whereas before, as you know, there were several applications. And quite a few times, we would have first-time freshmen fill out the graduate application because they graduated, right? So they filled out the graduate application. So that, fortunately, is going to be gone. But just be patient, because this is the first year we're going to have this. And I've been to a lot of meetings on this, and it's still in putting it together. It first went online on June 1st for those campuses that are on the quarter system. We're going to open for spring for those graduate programs we have. So we're going to have a taste of the application before October 1st comes. But just so you know, this is going to be a challenging year with a new application. Nobody knows how it works. So we're already committed, and I've already talked to my staff about the importance of doing more, CSU mentor application workshops, doing more workshops, having clinics on campus and things like that. That's really going to be key this year. If there's any year you attend the CSU Counselor Conference, make it this year, because that's going to be the framework of the application.
Is it sold out already?
Yeah.
Yeah. think the next one is in Escondido or San Diego or down there someplace, right? So the second thing you want to do is, like every year we offer a, in most campuses, I know Long Beach, I know Northridge, we all usually offer sometime in the fall a counselor update. Our counselor update, the key thing is going to be the Cal State application. So again, if you never go to a local campus's counselor update, because it is kind of a rah, 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 this is what's great about this, but this year especially, we're going to have that kind of information going. So if you can't make it to the CSU counselor conference, there will be material online so you can learn more about the application, but I would say try to find a campus that's having an update and join them on their campus for the update, because I guarantee you they'll be covering the new application. So, first thing is, work with your students. Most of the students that we deal with at Cal State LA, not all, but a lot of them qualify for the fee waiver. You get four campuses. So I think the first discussion, even before a student opens the application, is what four campuses do you realistically want to apply to? What are your top four choices? So before you even open the application, I think that discussion has to take place in terms of, I really want to go to, I'll give you an example. I really want to go to Northridge, but I want to study architecture. Okay, Northridge is not going to offer architecture. So the first thing you want to do, obviously, is make sure that they're in line with that. Know that there's only four fee waivers, so you know, choose wisely or help them choose wisely. So I can't talk more about the application because I really don't know what's going on beyond what I've already shared with you. They're still working on the fall application, so we'll see more as we come along. But everything I've heard is the application takes longer than the CSU Mentor application. There's more questions being asked, there's more detail. So I would say as you work with your students, let them know this is probably going to take a little longer than maybe your friend last year told you it took. It's probably going to take a lot longer than maybe a brother or sister who applied before. So make sure they don't wait till November 30th to apply, if at all possible, that they do it early. That way, if they do get stuck, they can talk to a campus rep, or they can call the campus, or they can come to you for some more information. I know a lot of our students wait till that either Thanksgiving break, or they wait till November 30th at about 10 o'clock at night, and that's when our server gets swarmed with all kinds of applications. But please tell them to try to do that ahead of time if all possible. So, they would need, I obviously know, they need their transcript and things like that to fill out the application. Hopefully they apply by November 30th. There's some campuses that do open beyond those dates, but I'd say anything in the LA Basin, it's pretty much going to be November 30th. I think Dominguez Hills might be the only campus that takes applications beyond that date. So that's first thing. What I really want to talk about is what happens after the application. A lot of times students think that once they apply, that's it. That's usually the students that end up coming across, not necessarily my desk, but those are the ones I see them because down the line they had their application withdrawn because they didn't follow a deadline. So the big thing is this, make sure that they understand filing their application by November 30th is only step one. It's what you do after that that's going to determine whether or not you're going to get to the end goal of enrolling in campus. For first-time freshmen, a lot of us do not ask for transcripts anytime earlier than by the point they graduate in June, but a lot of our students, they have to sign up for the ELM EPT test. They get information for us asking about, are you in the senior year experience? What classes are you taking? As we get closer, we have an enrollment confirmation deposit that's due by May 1st. We tell people you have to sign up for orientation by a specific date, okay? And then, if you are part of that Early Start program that's during the summer, you have to register for that by a certain date. And unfortunately, for each of these deadline dates, they get reminders, but once they miss those deadlines, and I can tell you this for Cal State LA, we will withdraw their application. So it's cut and dry. And obviously, if they were in the hospital or something, we get those occasionally. Those students file an appeal, and that's fine. But it's just like, I missed the deadline, they're going to be done. And that's, I can't emphasize that part enough. It's not November 30th that's a key deadline. It's all those deadlines that come up after that. And I've seen a lot of students who are really brokenhearted because they lost their spot. They thought they were in. They got conditionally admitted or provisionally admitted. They thought they were in, but they blew off the deadline. So one, make sure, just one more thing and I'll get to your question. Make sure that they're always checking their email. Make sure that they are always going onto the portal for the campus they're applying to. I guarantee you, any deadline we have that we've withdrawn students, we have sent them at least two or three emails saying, don't do this, this is your last chance. Okay, we guess you're not coming. I mean, we have our little pattern right there, but no one will be told the first time. They'll get two or three emails for any of these things. So I can't emphasize that enough. I don't know how many students have told us, you know what, I didn't read my email. And just so you know, here's a little secret. A lot of us use an email kind of service, I guess you want to call it, a company that kind of helps us do our emails. We know when somebody went in and opened an email or not. So a lot of times we'll have students tell us, oh, I never got that email. And we can actually look in there and say, yes, you did, and we see you open it. And that usually ends the conversation right there. Okay, so just so you know, that you know we can usually track that kind of stuff down. But that's what trips up students. I'm sorry.
That was it. I was going to ask how you remind them.
I can guarantee you, any deadline we have, I can tell you for a fact, we do about two or three reminders before that deadline. And that's usually, if there's any message I want to carry away today, I think because you're all counselors, you know, like, oh yeah, they have to fill out the application, oh, they have to get it in time, and they need their stuff. I'm not sure how many people know it's really what happens after. Is what trips up a lot of students. Okay, we work closely with the recruitment office. Fortunately, we're admissions and recruitment. I can tell you there was a time on our campus when admissions was over here and recruitment was over there, and you know we barely talked to each other. So it's real fortunate that we have the two together. We train all our recruitment people who go out, all our counselors. We actually train them on all the admissions processes. And in fact, when a student gets rescinded or a student is withdrawn and they want to appeal that decision, they're going to talk to a recruiter. So the recruiters know firsthand what the policies are, what the procedures are, and what happens and what goes wrong. So when they go out to the school sites, they share that message saying, hey, I'm the one who didn't do what they needed to do, and they're in my office crying and asking for that second chance, so I'm telling you, you know, don't do that. So it's really great that we have a really close relationship here on our campus with the recruitment office. We were just talking, as a matter of fact, today, because we're already looking at what we want to do for the fall. We want to make sure we get the message out to the counselors. We want to make sure we do the counselor update so counselors can learn on our campus about the application. And we're looking at doing clinics during the month of October and November, simply because it's a new application. It's not like CSU Manager where everybody knows how to fill it out. This is a new application, so those are some of the things we're gonna be doing. We're aligning our website, so there's information available on our website. We're going to go ahead and link to the Chancellor's office, because they'll have a tutorial, which isn't up yet, on their site about the application and things like that. Another big change about the application. And I'll be honest with you, from the admissions office side, it sounds great, but I think it could be challenging for some of our students. You can't file the application without paying. Before, you used to be able to file the application and then send a check to us. That's no longer an option. At the time of application, you either pay for the application online, or if you qualify for a fee waiver, the first floor campuses, that's where you can use your fee waiver. That's a huge difference. From our standpoint, we love it because we don't have to chase down those students. We can immediately start working on applications, not wondering whether or not that fee is going to come in, which would, you know, obviously make us withdraw the student if it didn't. But that's a challenge for students. That means they have to be aware. Another little tidbit, this may change before. We just met about the application, we're looking at it. One of the things we noticed is, it's kind of like when you shop online, you put stuff in the cart, you know, it's like that. You can put up to four campuses or how many campuses. Here's the thing that's scary. They're going to see the amount right there up front now. As soon as they put that in the cart, and at $55, and that's four, what's that, $220, whatever 55 times four is. So that may scare them, like, oh my God, I have to pay $220. Tell them not to worry. At the end of the application, that's when they're going to ask them about, you know, do you qualify for a fee waiver? You can use that. What we're telling them as admissions and recruitment people, try to connect those two closer. And I know maybe changes, so I'm giving you a heads up. Tell your students, don't freak out when you see how much the application is going to cost, because at the end, if you qualify for a fee waiver, that's going to offset that amount.
When you go shopping online, you put your little code in at the end. Yeah.
Right. But we just thought, you know, that could be a little disconcerting for some students and things like that. Okay? So that's a big thing this year. We have the new application. Wow. So other things that we do, we usually do something called a What's Next workshop. We started that with my team a couple of years ago to talk about just the things we talked about right now. So after the students file their application by November 30th, everyone's high school, so I don't have to talk community college, right?
Some of us have a lot to do at community college, so we keep in touch with them, but we're all high school based.
Okay. Because there's some things on community college I'll mention probably at the end just really quickly. Okay, going back to what I was saying about the freshman application. So I think the key here is, you know, you get your application in by November 30th, and then after that, my team, the recruitment people will go out to the schools, we'll be doing What's Next workshops. All the things I'm talking to you about, sign up for orientation, deadlines, checking your web, checking the website, going onto your portal, checking your email. We reinforce that message when we go out to school sites. They reinforce that message when they go out to school sites to make sure that students are aware that this is the kind of stuff that trips them up if they don't meet these kind of deadlines. Okay? So, questions?
Michael, did you have a question?
I think one of the issues that I have a lot of times with the Cal State application is when the students incorrectly put their income and their family size, and then they don't qualify for the fee waiver. Like, what is the actual procedure? Because I hear different things, and I don't know exactly. I've always told them, like, you send the paper one.
Yes, and that's exactly. I don't know with the new one what exactly is going to happen. Our past policy was this. Somebody filled out the application. They didn't qualify. And so what would happen is they could just mail in the paper application, fee waiver application, and we would take that.
Okay. It's like following up question. If they don't qualify even after that, and they choose to apply to less Cal States because maybe the cost is too much, is that a possibility, or do the students still owe money after that?
When the student fills out the application, that's central. However, after that, it goes to every campus.
Okay.
So they would have to get in contact with every campus. So they may decide that, I did qualify for the fee waiver. I applied to 6 campuses, but I'm only going to pay the fee at Cal State LA and Cal State Northridge.
Mm-hmm.
That's fine. Those other 4 campuses will just withdraw their applications down the line.
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
But they're not going to be charged or anything, because I remember somebody saying about that happening to a student that they were.
They just won't review the application.
They won't review.
Yeah, I was going to say I can't. That's one of those I can't speak for everybody in the CSU system. We've never done that. And I don't know, I can't think of another campus that has. I'm not saying no one, someone's not, but usually what happens if you don't pay for the application by a certain date, like December 15th, in the past, you're done.
With the new application that you guys are going to have, are you going to have the fee waiver online as well?
The fee waiver is part of the application.
Okay.
And so it'll go through, and actually when the student enters the information you're talking about, family size, family income, it'll say, you qualify for the fee waiver. Now here's the thing, again, they're still building this. I don't think it's really clear which campuses get the fee waiver. I think it's the first 4 campuses, that's what the fee waiver will apply to. So they apply for 6 or 7,
right.
They have to understand the first 4 will get that fee waiver. Anything after that, they're gonna have to pay for it.
And if they do qualify for the fee waiver, we know they do as a school, we know that they do, but they don't qualify or they get rejected online. What's the process for them to then submit to you the information that they qualify?
Again, because I know with CSU Mentor, we used to just ask them, submit the paper application to our campus specifically.
Right.
I'm not sure because we're not quite sure where they are on that. I don't know if they're going to centralize that now, or it'll still be fill out the paper, send it to us, and that takes care of it.
Because there used to be a form that you could just go on CSU Mentor and then download the actual paper
form,
and submit it to the
campus, right.
Oh, yes.
We're not 100% certain
what's
going to happen. We've heard some of it. Like I said, it's going to show which ones it counted for and stuff like that, but I'm not sure yet how that's going to be handled.
Now, why is it that some Cal States are taking longer to tell the students how much financially they're going to get.
Yes.
It's taking sometimes, it's May 1st, and students haven't heard from you guys as
yes.
to their award letters. And so they're like, okay, I don't know what school I'm going to go out because I don't know how much money I'm going to be getting. And
right.
so it's very difficult for them to make a decision by May 1st when they haven't heard from you guys about financial aid.
So I can, again, I can speak two hats, the CSU and Cal State LA.
Well, Cal State LA.
Cal State LA, not guarantees, but Cal State LA last year sent out all financial aid awards by April 1st. Every student who applied had that by April 1st. If they didn't, it's because they didn't submit some. And we are committed to do that again this year. It took a lot of pain for the financial aid office. It's a lot of work, but we're committed to make sure every student has a decision by April 1st and has an award letter by April 1st. If a student doesn't, my suggestion is dig a little deeper, because more than likely, maybe they didn't turn in the form, maybe they're flagged for verification and we needed to have something in. But usually, if you dig a little deeper, you're going to find there's an email and you're going to find that a student didn't submit something.
Have you guys tried a different way to notify students that something is due as opposed to an email? Because it isn't working. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you. I keep telling students, review your emails constantly, almost on a weekly basis, if not on a daily basis, and they're not checking. They're just not checking. They don't check emails. They just don't.
Again, I can speak to our campus and not other campuses. Now, at Cal State LA, a student can go into their portal. We did this a little bit last year, but it's certainly going to be in place this year. When the student goes into the portal, every email that financial aid has sent them is right there. All they have to do is click on it, and they can view it. They don't even have to go into their email. We have a new different system, that Hobson system I talked to you about, that's going away. Okay, and financial aid never used that. But we have a different system. I'm not going to get into logistics, but actually now, because of what you said, because of the number of students, even though we tell them, check your email, they don't. If they go into their portal, every email that financial aid sends them is going to be there. And all they have to do is click on it. If they don't go to their portal, I can't help them.
Is it just financial aid emails, or would it be any emails from any part, any office in the university?
Right now, it's going to be financial aid, and it's going to be
admissions.
Us two are going to be doing that.
Good.
Yeah. Because of what you said, exactly.
It's very frustrating. I mean, from a counselor perspective, it's very frustrating. We tell the students, have you opened a portal? What is that? I'm like, what do you mean, what is that?
Here's the reality.
Welcome to the world.
It's just, remember, 58,000 applications, so you can matter. Especially, the great thing about email is, it's very cost effective, so I can send out 3 or 4 nudges or reminders. You can't do that if you're doing snail mail. And with snail mail, they may not open it either. Trust me, it's something that we've gone back and forth on. I don't know how many students I've talked to. I never opened my email, and you're thinking, you applied to college, why would you not? But there's anything
I know.
To read.
A lot of colleges now, are like the common application now says, are you willing to be texted?
Okay.
Is that an option, do you know, in this one?
I don't think you want to send the whole text, but maybe something, and that costs money too.
No, the only text would be, text would say, check your email.
Yeah. Right.
You know?
We're not there.
Okay.
I think what we will do this year is all the emails will be on the portal for financial aid and for admission.
Okay.
So if you can't get them to open their email, tell them at least go to their portal
right.
so they can check that information. And I think financial aid actually requires you to go to their portal to click in and accept your financial aid. That's the other big thing. As you know, it started last year, the whole thing called Prior, which just basically means students can start to apply for financial aid as of October 1st. So in terms of, we actually call the main message, right? This is the main message we try to get out to students. One, go online, check the campuses, decide who you want to apply for, what programs you want to apply for, and go ahead and submit your application. Second, once you submit your application now, apply for financial aid. That's the other thing you want. So that's kind of our main message. Now, I talked about the ELM-EPT test. How many of you are familiar with that? There is a lot of talk, and maybe you guys have heard this, the ELM-EPT is going away. That test, maybe this fall, will no longer exist. As soon as I don't say pencil. That's why I say it stays in this room. room, but it definitely is a conversation, and it seems to be told to us, at least, and things can change, but it looks very strongly that may go away as soon as this year.
Does that mean something else will replace it, or?
I think we're going to be going off SAT or ACT test scores.
Only?
Well, and then you have the EAP that they take their junior year. I can tell you for Cal State LA, and probably for every impacted campus, you're required now to take the SAT or ACT test. That's going to be a requirement for us. Anyone who's impacted is going to have that requirement. And let me talk about impaction for a second, but did you have a question before?
Even if you have a 3.0 or higher GPA?
Yes.
Is it required?
Yes. Everybody, regardless of your GPA for Cal State LA, is required to take the SAT or the ACT test. That's a requirement. And that's new for our campus. If you look at other impacted campuses, they more than likely have the same requirement. And this is why. We, especially if you're out of area, we need to rank you. If you're local to us, it's not going to be a problem. But if you're out of area, in some programs, they're going to be ranking, and they need to have a test score to do that. So that's why you're required to take the SAT or ACT. So let's talk about impaction. How many people have heard the word impaction before? Doesn't sound like a dental procedure. It is. We try to use other words because impaction sounds really terrible. But regardless of what you call it, it comes down to the fact that if a student applies to campus sometimes, there's more applications than there are slots. That can happen on two ways. Again, I'm going to focus in on freshmen because most everyone here is dealing with freshmen. So that either means, one, that we have more freshman applications as a whole, or it means we have more applications in one particular department, let's say psychology. Again, it varies from campus to campus. This is the way we're dealing with it. Anyone who's local, and if you go on our website, we will define our local area and tell you the schools that are in our local area. It's the schools that are closest to our campus. This way it goes all the way down to the 605 freeway. That way it goes all the way out to Firestone, more or less, Boulevard. This way it goes out to, like, Fairfax. And that way it goes forever. We literally go over the mountains, the squirrels, the bears, they're all local to us, all the way to Palmdale. Okay, so that's kind of our local area. Okay? If a student lives in our local area, they only have to meet the minimum admission requirements. Okay, so in other words, as long as they have that eligibility index of 2900 and they've taken all their A through G classes and things like that, we will admit that student. If you live outside our area, for instance, if you go to Baldwin Park or anything on the other side of the 605 freeway, your index is not 2900. This last year it had to be 3850, which is really, really, really high. Yeah. So find out when the student's applying who's local to you, because that local campus is the best chance they have to get in.
Regarding those numbers that you're saying, is there a place where we can find those numbers, like by campus?
It's going to be on, not always, but it's usually on everybody's website. Not always. I usually would say ask the recruiters. When our recruiters go out, we share that information. We never know what it's going to be for this year. We only know when it was for the previous year. Because it all depends on the number of apps you get, how big your class size is going to be, and that determines that. But for, it sounds like most of you are local to us.
Is anybody not in our local area? So you're in who's? Is Dominguez?
Yes.
Yeah. So Narvaez and Dominguez and Harbor Teacher Prep.
Carson.
Carson.
Okay. So probably Dominguez would be, your local campus. So anyone who's local to us, as long as they meet 2900 and meet all the other requirements, they're going to be admissible. We have impacted majors. In the past, our impacted majors, you had to meet, like psychology, I think the cutoff was 3,200 last year. I think it was cutoff for psychology. But this year, we've changed our impaction, so giving preference to local. Anyone who is local to us, who meets the regular admission requirements, will be admitted into even impacted majors, except nursing. Nursing is like a whole different thing. Into impacted majors as a pre-major. Ah. So what you have to do as a pre-major is take certain courses and then formally apply to the major within a year or two. something called an eligibility index. And the way this works is the eligibility index is, I'll use the example, an SAT score plus the GPA, CSU GPA, sophomore, junior, and senior year, A through D classes, times 800. So let's say you have a 3.0 GPA. Multiply that by 800, that's 2,400. Let's say they get 900 on their SAT. So that plus the SAT score will give you their eligibility index. And that's on, if you guys haven't used this, go on the CSU website. There's something called the Counselor's Handbook. It's an online resource. It has all the information I'm explaining to you now. It'll go in through what A through G classes are. It'll say which classes count, which classes won't. It'll talk about validation, which classes, if you do poorly in, which you take the next level and do better in, it validates the whole sequence of classes. All that is on that counselor handbook. Or actually, it's called the admissions handbook. It's not called the counselor handbook. Okay. So, once again, the way Impaction works is most of you are going to have local students. So, for Cal State LA at least, they're all going to have to only meet the minimum requirements. Even for impacted majors, they only have to meet the minimum requirements, and they'll be admitted as pre-majors. And then they'll have to follow a sequence to get admitted into the major, either at the end of their freshman or sophomore year.
Can they get direct entry into their majors?
No.
No direct entry? Okay.
Well, yes, if they're applying to a non-impacted major, let's say they're applying to health science, that's not impacted. They'll be admitted directly into the major. And all of these majors I'm talking about are now on our website. Okay, so it's very clear, this is our local area. These are our impacted majors, although we call them major-specific criteria. Majors that have major-specific criteria. Yes?
So a question, what happens when you have a student say they went to Carson?
Okay.
And senior year, if something happens, they move right over here and go to Willis.
Okay.
Do they still count in the eligibility index for you guys then? Say, because I'm saying, say they meet the eligibility index for your school now that they've moved from Carson to the local area.
At the time they apply, whatever high school they enter there, if that's a local high school, we will treat them local. If they move after that, but still during their senior year, I would say make sure they change that high school if it's to their advantage on that application. Otherwise, they won't be considered local. That's not the case with community college. Community college is a whole different thing. Okay? But for high school, at least, it's wherever you graduated high school from. And if they move to Wilson, they become a local student. But if they applied as a Carson student, and our application shows Carson, they would need to change that over. Other questions?
Question, do all Cal States calculate their GPA the same?
Yes, we should, because we all use that same admissions handbook.
I say this because this year I had one of my students, he was denied to Cal State LA, which is our local school, because he didn't meet the index, and he was admitted to CSUN.
Okay.
So that didn't make sense to me. But he did an appeal.
He did?
Yeah, he appealed, but the appeal was...
What was the major?
He went in undeclared to both.
It shouldn't, and I would say appeal. Well, he did. So maybe Northridge didn't catch something.
I didn't call him.
Yeah. How's this? He's in Northridge. We're doing that.
I called him.
Yeah. But that would be highly unusual because we're going off the same. We're going off the same guidelines for A through G classes. That shouldn't be. That should not be different.
You're saying maybe Northridge.
If you appealed it, automatically when the student appeals for something like that, we have a second evaluator and lead evaluator take a look at it. So yeah, I would say that means if somebody appealed and we said yeah, that's the case, that means at least three pairs of eyes looked at that document.
So whatever GPA Cal State LA calculated, because he appealed and it was seen a second, third time, then that's the correct GPA.
I would not tell.
I didn't.
Don't say anything about it.
Yeah.
How are you working now with kids who get D's and F's and then retake the class?
As long as they retake it by the end of their senior year, in other words, before they graduate, we will take those grades. So
okay.
As long, that's fine. That's why I unfortunately, I've had cases where we deny people or we rescind their admissions because they reported one thing and their transcript turned out to be another thing. And it isn't until we have that meeting with the student and the parent that the parent finds out, I never knew you got that grade. So.
How about the situation, let's say that it was a flat fail semester to you, what if they do take it in summer school then?
As long as they take it in summer school, in summer of their freshman, sophomore, junior year. Mm. Once you graduate, that seals your transcript.
That's right,
sealed. That seals your record.
But if they end up going for the August graduation?
No, just, that doesn't exist.
Yeah, it's going to be,
not for,
they have to do it.
Not for the Cal State.
So my suggestion would be this. You can never account for somebody getting a D or F their second semester. I mean, you want to tell students don't get senioritis, you know, don't fall into that. But if you see somebody getting a D or F for a A through G requirement
English,
the first
right.
semester, you want to get them to make sure they make up that class, because if they make it up, we will take it if they do it by the end of spring.
What if it's in a course that they no longer need, that it's in like you know, it's extras beyond the A through G requirements, and these are just extra, like AP psychology, let's say.
That's not going to make a difference other than that grade's going to bring down their GPA.
Yeah, but as long as everything else is okay.
That's not going
to
be a problem.
If they took a year of chemistry and then they decided to take AP chemistry, and in AP chemistry they get their silly D.
Right.
It's not going to knock them out because they didn't need it.
Correct.
It just lowers
their
GPA.
They have that year of chemistry there already. Unfortunately, now they have a D or F grade that's going to be calculated because it is an A through G course.
Yeah. Is that the case for all the Cal States, or is it just here at Cal State LA?
I would say that's pretty, what you're talking about right now is pretty much standard.
Okay.
That's pretty much across the board.
When it comes to notifying the schools about students failing a class that they need, or they post it as planning to take, even though they don't need it to graduate, should they still communicate with you guys, I'm failing this class even though I don't might not need it?
No, because I would say sometimes we get people telling us, hey, I think I'm going to get a D or F in this class. Is that going to affect my admissions? And we'll go back and tell them, yeah, it will, if that's one of your A through G classes. But something like that, just know, though, that it's probably going to bring down their GPA.
Right.
Will it change your eligibility number?
But I tell the kids, communicate with the universities regardless so they are aware of it, just in case.
It's always a good practice to do that.
Right.
Here's the thing. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, my question is, though, it will affect their eligibility score, right? Because their GPA
goes. It depends. Like, if somebody has a 3.4 or 3.5, if their eligibility is already 3,400, a D or F is not going to make a difference. However, if they're at 2,902, that could make a difference.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, and this is why we rescind, I'd say, about 200 to 250 freshmen. Those are students who've done everything they were supposed to, who pay their enrollment confirmation, turn in their transcripts, and when we see their final transcripts, what turns out to be is not always what they put on their application.
Wow.
And sometimes it's because they out and out lied to us, okay? Once in a while that does happen. But I can't tell you how many times they get that D or F that last semester. If you get a D or F your last semester in English, in math, if you're like in Algebra 2, not if you're advanced, it's going to knock you out. And it's like the traffic ticket you put in the glove compartment. They think no one's going to know. But sometimes they think, hey, it's the middle of July. I haven't gotten a call. Hey, it's the end of July. Keep in mind, 58,000. So we're working our way through all those transcripts. So it's unfortunate. Everybody knows. Here's the thing that kills me about this when I have those difficult conversations. I want to tell them, you knew this. The day that report card arrived in June, you knew this before we did. And you didn't make the call like the guy said, hey, this happened, what do I do? Okay? You could have went to community college. I know it's a difficult conversation to have with your parents, but it's better than having your parent there and me there in the office and you're telling them for the first time, oh, guess what? I got a D. You know, that's not the place to have that conversation. So I can't tell you enough, especially in this hyper admissions environment, if someone gets a D or F, that's going to be it. We're gonna rescind it.
Is that the case also, like, they're taking a physics class and they want to drop it? Do they still need to notify you?
Not really. Again, the only thing is this. Is it going to be, are they using it for their A through G requirement? If they're not, it's not going to make a difference. And especially if they drop the class, it's not going to appear on their GPA. Unlike other systems, we're not going to penalize somebody because, hey, you're taking that AP physics, you dropped it. That shows that, you know, you're not dedicated. We're going to drop your admissions. We're not. The good or bad thing about CSU admissions, it's really straight up numbers. What's your, did you get the HG classes? What's your GPA? Mm-hmm. What's your test score? Let's multiply it. This is your EI. That's it. It doesn't matter if they wrote it. We'll even take an essay. None of that's going to matter with the CSU. The UCs, it's different. That's why it's quicker to fill out the CSU application than the UC application, because you don't have to do an essay.
On the activities.
Right. Now, the other thing, though, is a lot of our students qualifying would benefit for the EOP program. Mm-hmm. That's the Educational Opportunity Program. Make sure your students are interested in that. They check off that box when they're actually applying, and make sure they follow through, because now the EOP application is going to be embedded in the Cal State application.
No way.
Yeah.
So they don't have those different deadlines anymore.
Right.
Oh,
it's going to
wow.
be embedded. Well, no. It's going to be embedded. They can submit that later, but as soon as they indicate EOP, that application will come up for them.
Can they submit it then if they want to?
They can submit it.
Oh,
that
changes everything.
Yeah. So. And that one, there's letters of recommendation, there are personal statements, and EOP will consider that. So there isn't an essay for the CSU application. There is an essay for, not an essay, but there are prompts that they have to answer for the EOP.
So they'll have the four schools in their little box, in their little, and then will the EOP go to all four of them at that same time?
That's what my understanding
is.
Oh,
wow.
Goes to all four. But as long as they check they're interested, there's actually a
that
later deadline
so
date.
Yeah, that's so fabulous because they always have to go back and hit the four later. Oh, wow.
So now they embedded EOP in the application, which makes things a lot easier.
Oh, my gosh. That's fabulous.
Other questions I can answer. I hope I give you an idea. If nothing else, I hope I leave you with the idea that the application process doesn't end on November 30th. In fact, that's when it starts because it's the things that come after that I see time and time and time again. And I'm talking about, I'm telling you this as an admissions director, this year for fall 17, when you looked at people who didn't pay their ECD on enrollment confirmation deposit on time, people who didn't sign up for orientation, people who didn't sign up for that early start program, all those kind of things, we're talking about a couple of hundred students that we withdrew their applications. People who wanted to come here. So it's a real number. It's a real... It makes a real difference. So if nothing else, go back and tell them, read all your emails, check your portals, and just because you submitted the application, that's only step one. Make sure you do everything that comes after that.
So could we talk about recruiters for 1 second?
Sure.
How many recruiters do you have right now?
Six. So with 58,000 applications, divide that by six.
Oh my gosh, are you kidding?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So it's a challenge. Our biggest challenge is how many of you work for, like you said, it's some of the bigger campuses, but a lot of charter schools?
No charters. All LAUSD, but pilots.
Pilots.
So like Torres or Miguel Contreras or...
See, here's the thing that was great. I think it's much better because the student has better experience at a smaller school. It's a challenge for us. Belmont, for those of you who've been around long enough, at one point had like 5,000 students, right? So when we went out to Belmont, we went to one school visit and we had all these students. Now it's broken up into all those different high schools. Our challenge is to reach the same number of students. That recruiter has to go to about 6 or 7 places. Okay. So that's a little bit challenging. I won't lie to you. We don't get out as much as we used to. Not that they're not out there. It's just that there's a lot more schools they have to visit.
So what I've been telling them is like at Torres or at Rivera, I mean, you're going to need to have joint places for them to be. They're going to have to share in order to make it possible for you guys to come.
If those of you who are at those schools can do that, you would be our best friend, because that's one of the challenges.
That's what we do. We usually have all the counselors from the small schools. We have meetings once a month.
Right.
And we get everybody together when we have college reps come in and talk to them. So all
that would be a lot better. I don't want to say which one it is, but there's literally a school that has 3 or 4 campuses.
Right.
They will not pull people together. We have to literally go to 3 or 4 campuses that are literally from here to the next building, which is a little bit frustrating for us. So anything you can do to make that happen, we certainly would cooperate. And our recruiters, when they go out there, you can let them know, hey, you know what, you're here, but we can also get you know, X, Y, and Z to be here at the same
so
time.
Who has a recruiter come to your campus from Cal State LA?
I do.
Honors program usually comes.
The Honors program comes to her school because she's
oh, okay.
They're all getting AAs at the same time.
Okay.
But these are all the majority of people in this section right here are all in our service area.
Oh, okay.
So
how many LA
recruiters
should
be in our service area?
Anyone who's going to the CSU conference, make sure you stop by our table, talk to the reps, find out who's in your area. Could be Frank Cornelio, it could be Salvador Garcia. It depends where you are, but at least stop by the table and get somebody's card. That way you can at least get a visit out to you. And if you can tell them, hey, if you come out to my school, I can get school X, Y, and Z there, then you have a much higher probability of getting a visit.
Robert, do you guys work together?
Like with the other schools?
Yeah.
Not so much.
They're at the Gil Contreras, right in the heart of our service.
Oh, no, I know where it is.
Yeah,
so if you guys can work together, that would make
you
life
need, you
so
need,
much
you
better.
You need to explain to the principals that you're making it hard for the college.
I don't know if it's so much the principals.
No, it makes it hard for the college to devote that service to you that you need because it's just not labor intensive.
This year it's going to be
hard to get together.
I know.
When a student makes up